big day in India. Votes polled in elections in Gujarat and Himachal Pradesh are being counted, and the counting has just begun a few seconds back. The process is starting, as I said, as we speak, and the first trends are expected by about 9 a.m. Apart from Ahmedabad, where all the action is taking place this morning, WION is going live to Chicago, New York, Beijing and Kathmandu to get your 360-degree perspective on the big import of these elections. The world is watching these polls, and WION will get you the best slice of it.
And yes, you know, before we go to our experts who are assembled in our studio, let me go across straight to my colleague, Mohammed Saleh, who is there with us and going to give us a roundup of as to how these elections have been reported by major newspapers, tabloids and websites in India. Saleh, to you.
Absolutely, indeed, Kartikeya. Thank you very much, indeed. Now, if you were to look at every single newspaper in India, this, of course, is the big story. Let me take you through some of the headlines that they've, in fact, put out. For instance, the Indian Express, which is, made it their top headline, saying, Nation watches Gujarat today. And they've also said, after high-pitched battle, BJP hopes to tide over the Patidar anger rise of youth leaders, critically hinting out at the leaders who are likely to make a change, Hardik Patel, Jignesh Biwani, amongst others. Now, the Hindu is, of course, again, has made it a top headline, counting in Gujarat and Himachal today. Acrimonious campaign. Arguably, in the last several decades, there perhaps hasn't been another electoral battle that's been as acrimonious as this present one that we've seen in Gujarat. And the Times of India has, of course, made this one of their top, but look at the angle that they've taken. EVM row erupts on the eve of Gujarat results, because this is something which several Congress leaders have in fact come out and said. Hardik Patel has also spoken about the possibility of EVM hacking, and this is of course what the Times of India is talking about. If you were to look at the Hindustan Times, it says breaking down the ballot, a look at how the crucial state of Gujarat voted as counting takes place for the 182 seats today. And also it is about essentially a prestige battle for Narendra Modi as he, you know, prepares himself for the 2019 battle. So it is verdict in Prime Minister's home state, which is to set the tone for 2019, essentially talking about the criticality of what it means for Narendra Modi. And let's also take a look at what some of the Hindi newspapers have reported on this story. Amar Ujala, for instance, has headlined it as Kiske Sirtaj Faisla Aaj, who will, of course, wear the crown to become the king of Gujarat. And also one of the other very popular Hindi newspapers, which has said, Natije se pehle Hardik aur Congress bole EVM hacking ki saazish. So there are several issues here. This, of course, is a very important battle, both for Narendra Modi and also for Rahul Gandhi. Perhaps the stakes have never been higher, because Gujarat has a government that's been incumbent for the last 22 years. And for Rahul Gandhi, this is the time where the proof is in the proof of the pudding is in the eating, because now he's Congress president, the buck stops with him, and there's absolutely nowhere to hide. So the accountability effectively will rest on his shoulders if there were to be a defeat. This is how the media, of course, the newspapers have covered this story. Back to you, Kartikeya.
Thank you very much, Saleh. And I have to say, for a Bangalorean, you're doing a pretty good job with the Hindi headlines there. Kushan, I interrupted you before we went into a break. You wanted to make a point about...
I wanted to just say that Rahul didn't have much of a choice taking over as president. You know, everybody says he chose the time to... His mother is very unwell. Let's not... I mean, Sonia Gandhi's fallen
ill a couple of times. So he didn't have a choice, you're saying, to be...
She did not campaign this heavily, that heavily this time, because she's been unwell. So, keeping her as president, he was possibly, you know, making his mother get worse in terms of her health situation. She's run the party for a long, long time, and she needed to retire more than he needed to take over. I mean, she's run the party, she effectively ran the country for 10 years. So, I mean, she...
She ran the party... she built the alliances, she got them to power twice, and her legacy has also pitfalls. You know, there is no Congress in Bihar, there is no Congress in Andhra, there is no Congress in Telangana. It's not because of Rahul Gandhi, it's because of Sonia Gandhi, procrastination over 2G, the procrastination over coal. Both sides. So when we talk about Rahul, we must remember this is what he inherits. But before we go into that,
these are the latest pictures.
The shots are coming now.
Yes, and the first trends also, the BJP leading in one seat, but this is very early days, of course. Counting is on in 37 centres, if I'm not wrong. 851 candidates are in the fray. This is a very big election. The voting was conducted in
them phases. Palki millionaires in Gujarat.
Yes.
Most of them. Let's fire those graphics and let's understand the vote share. What's the basic difference in 2012? You look at the vote share, you know, the gap is substantial. It's not 1%, it's not 2%, it's 48% and 39%, which is, it's a difference of 9%. 9%. So even if, you know, I know it's a conjunctural hypothesis, even if I say that the Congress is doing very well and we can see visibly and it jumps to 45%, you know, you still have that Bharatiya Janata Party sitting with 48%. And one has to see...
It went up in the Lok Sabha election.
Lok Sabha election...
BJP, 60 to 33.
It became a different ballgame. It became 60. And as you mentioned, and you'll be very surprised, only in two assembly segments, if you do the data analysis, only in two assembly segments, Congress led. In rest of the assembly segments, BJP led.
Sharad Gupta, good morning and welcome to the coverage. We also have Harish Khurana, I'm told, BJP spokesperson, joining us from the BJP office in New Delhi. Good morning, Mr. Khurana. All set?
All set. Good morning.
What do you think the numbers? What do you think the numbers hold for you today? What is your calculation?
See, we are pretty confident the way Gujarat people has voted for us. We are pretty confident about that, and you will see next 1 or 2 hours what we are aiming at 150 plus. We are going to surely and definitely we are going to cross that figure. The reason behind is the way since last 22 years, Mr. Narendra Modi. Led by Mr. BJP government, led by Mr. Modi, and now by Vijay Rupani, the way we are serving the Gujarat people, the way we are developing it, we are pretty confident that we will be crossing 150 plus.
Mr. Khurana, you are saying that it will be 150 plus, but that's the motto of the Bharatiya Janata Party. So you are basically saying that Hardik Patel or Alpesh Thakur or you know, other factors, you know, which created popular disruptions of the so-called, the word which was created in media, the boys from Gujarat, have had no impact on the elections. Are you saying that?
See, this is an election between development and the casteism done by Congress people. Where are the old people of Congress? Where are Solanki ji? Where are Govil ji? Where are other Congress guys? They were left behind. In UP, there were two boys, and over here there are three boys, which are going to destroy the Congress aspect. The reason is, this was the only Congress who says we will not do casteism politics. And in the whole election, they were not talking about development. Vikas pagal ho gaya. These kind of phrases which were used, the Gujarat people will give the answer. We have already given the answer, and you will see next few hours, this answer will be given through the EVM machines.
But you know, sir, but I just don't get this agreement. When you say that, you know, it's all about caste when it comes to the Congress party. But doesn't Bharatiya Janata Party, for example, every party, any party at any given point of time, sir, distributes ticket on the basis of caste? But how can you say that the caste is irrelevant when it comes to the electoral decisions? You know, BJP does the same. If you, and I'm sorry, it's a long question I'm asking. If you look at the way the seats have been, tickets were given in UP, maximum number of tickets went to the upper caste and OBC when it comes to Uttar Pradesh elections. So caste is something pervasive. Unwanted but pervasive in every political party, sir.
No, I'll tell you the criteria of giving the distribution in BJP has never been a casteism factor. That's as a spokesperson, I definitely say that there's no criteria of caste because you belong to this caste, we'll give the ticket. No, never. One. Secondly, This is talking. I'm talking about the double standard of the Congress government, Congress people. Congress used to say we will not do casteism politics. We will not do any kind of politics which is hatred kind of thing. What they have done in this whole elections, they have put Jignesh, they have put Hardik, they have put Alpesh Thakur, which were the symbols of casteism in Gujarat. One. Secondly, I would like to ask these Congress people. Where are their old leaders? Where are their Solanki ji? Where are their Govil ji? Who are serving the Congress since last 30 years? They have been behind. So this shows Congress don't have the leadership. They have a leadership. Only Rahul Gandhi was available everywhere. But what about the local leaders? So it was an election only and only Rahul Gandhi with all these three ladkas, boys, what we call this.
Yes, and you had the Prime Minister of India, so that's not very different. But let me go to
Prime Minister of India minus LK Advani and Murali Manohar Joshi.
Yes, and maybe Amit Shah, who held 31 rallies. But do stay with us, sir. And we are going to Chicago. Manasvi is standing by with the reactions there and how people in Chicago are looking at these election results. Manasvi, if you can hear me, bring us the flavor of what this evening is like in Chicago and how people there are looking at what this result will mean for the Prime Minister of India.
Yes, I can hear you. Absolutely. Hello, everyone. And I'm bringing to you election coverage live from a very special place. It's called Ronald Reagan Community Center here in Chicago. Now, why is this special? This is special because in 2012 Gujarat elections and the landslide victory of Narendra Modi, my father, Shalabh Kumar, he took out like huge ads in Indian newspapers calling him the Ronald Reagan of India. And chairman of US Congress, Pete Sessions, took that one step further and he called him the Ronald Reagan of India. So here I am 5 years later covering the perspective of Hindu and Indian Americans in United States on one of the most important state elections in India in the states of Gujarat and Himachal Pradesh. Now this will be the biggest battle for Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi. He's facing some adversity in India, especially in his home state Gujarat. There's the impact of demonetization, the GST that affects the trader community, there's the Patidar movement, the Dalit movement, and of course there's this whole anti-incumbency mood. On the other hand, we have Rahul Gandhi, who's newly been appointed as the president of Indian National Congress. So will this election be a litmus test for him? Let's ask this distinguished panel here for their opinions. So I'm going to start with Brij Sharma. He's an industrialist and a core member of Republican Hindu Coalition. Hi, Brij.
Hello.
What do you think the outcome of this election will be?
Clearly, the outcome of this election is going to be BJP and Modi's victory. And that's absolutely necessary for India. Now, there is issues like GST, issues like demonetization, and so on. Mm-hmm. But above all, the issues are India and the Indians.
Absolutely.
Modi ji has put India and the Indians on the world stage.
Yeah.
And that only Modi ji could achieve.
Absolutely.
So that's the reason we would like India, Modi ji, BJP to win the election. And I'm fully confident BJP and Modi ji is going to have a landslide victory in this election.
Wow, that's some confidence. Let's go to Krishna Bansal here. He is an IT company owner in Chicago. So Krishna, you know, you have been so involved in RHC's activity and you're a leader here. And I see you in so many great events and we're having events in future as well. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Is this a referendum on GST, the demonetization? What do you think of Modi's style of governance? What do you think the general atmosphere is?
Well, first, let me talk about the Modi style of governance, as mm-hmm. you brought it up, Manasvi. It is a wonderful, I mean, that's the style India was looking for since the independence, and we never got that. This is the first time we in America, as non-resident Indians, we have never been more prouder since Modi ji took over. Mm-hmm. This is such a moment here when we go out, people know Modi ji here. People know what's going on in India. Mm-hmm. India is no more a country that used to be looked at as, oh, it's a country of elephants and snake charmers or anything. India is looked at as a country on the world stage. That's what Modi ji has created. Now, talking about the GST and the demonetizations, and those are the things that were absolutely necessary as we are looking from outside. These are the things that have given India that world stage mm-hmm. as Modi ji took those bold steps. Mm-hmm. Now, whenever you take a bold step, I mean, so of course, there are people who don't like you and they may like to make them as issues. Now, you may call them as a referendum, but I don't think so. They are real referendum. People are really looking at the prosperity. People are looking at the development. People are looking at what is going on in terms of the corruption. I mean, we saw lakhs and crores of rupee corruption that was happening from last many years. We all lost faith. Now that faith has built up. We all are so geared up to work with India, work with Modi ji, the government, and work with here. And then Trump, President Trump, he has really put in everything that he has said he is the true friend of India. Mm-hmm. So I think Modi ji has shown he has led us in the right way, and we all are looking for his victory today by a big landslide.
Got it. So let's talk about Rahul Gandhi here. Mm-hmm. He's been newly appointed as the president of mm-hmm. Congress. And do you think this will be a test for him? Do you think this will dictate the future of Rahul Gandhi? I'm going to ask Vandana Jingan here. She's also known as Didi here. She is the candidate and a prominent, she's a candidate for the elections here. And she's a prominent member of Republican Hindu Coalition. And I hope you will be the next congresswoman from District 8, Illinois. So what do you think? Let's go to Rahul Gandhi here and his...
Manaswi, first of all, thank you. And the question that you asked, I mean, made me laugh too. When we talk about the gentleman that you have asked, that he's been made the leader, and what we are seeing it, because something come on a platter, because the dynasty, the rule has to, because that is what has been proving. There were many more capable people, those who are in the Congress party, they should have been given a chance, but that has not happened, and that's been proven again and again. And let's see where it takes. He was camping in Gujarat for a very long time, and we did saw what the results and the outcome was. He lost the UP itself, which belonged to them and their family. Let's see and watch what people are going to do for his leadership. And if something is passed, nothing should be given on a platter to anybody. You have to earn the way you see me.
Got it. So Rahul Gandhi has been campaigning with a lot of youth leaders, and considering that a lot of people voting in Gujarat are young, let's see what this outcome will be. I'm going to go to Jayashree right now, and Jayashree has seen RHC's journey, you know, right from the year and a half with President Trump, and she has seen how President Trump is a great fan, is admirer of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and his win here in Gujarat election is really important to maintain his hold, you know, for the 2019 elections. So let's ask Jayashree, what's your opinion, Jayashree, and what do you think the outcome will be?
Obviously, it's going to be landslide victory, just because what... Oh, okay. All right, so I would just say that, you know, being an Indian, what we've seen so far, you know, what Narendra Modi and Trump administration, what RHC have done so far work, we wanted to make sure that they're like joined by the hip, and we wanted to keep momentum going, and that's what we're looking for. So this victory is very important, and I'm sure we're going to have a landslide victory.
Okay, another question for you. Okay. So tell us about the journey. So I know RHC, I've been a part of it. There was a narrative that was set by my father, Shalabh Kumar, when we started supporting President Trump a year and a half back. And he came to October 15th rally, and he proclaimed, you know, we love Hindus, we love India, and, you know, if elected, I will be a true friend of Narendra Modi, and, you know, Hindus will have a true friend in the White House. Mm-hmm. So what do you think, how does this election, will the outcome of this election before this, the Trump administration and the Hindus and Indians in America?
So let me start with, first of all, what Shalabh Kumarji started, a movement. And before even he went to support President Trump, he made sure, he worked with him to make sure that, does Trump really support India? Does Trump really has that thing in his heart to support us, the Hindus? And after doing that, when he got the clear answers, he said, yeah, he's the right person. And we all supported wholeheartedly. And President-elect at that, or candidate Trump at that time reciprocated. He came to our rally. And Hindus played a huge role in his victory. And it was all due to Shalabh Kumar and RHC that happened. Now, since then, what we have seen is India and Modi and Trump, they are seen as the global leaders who are looking to lead the entire global economy, the global leadership, in a different direction. Mm-hmm. India is no longer looked at as a third world country. India is no longer looked at as someone who's that country that is lagging behind, a poor country or anything like that. India is looked at as now the country that is playing on the center stage, whether it's the center stage for economy, center stage for power. That is what it is. We saw in a lot of statements that President made last time, just in his recent visit to Asia, where he said India is a center stage player and India should be working directly with the as a leader in the Asian Pacific region. And that's what we are seeing. So with this, Modiji and Trump, these two world leaders are going to shape the future of the generations to come. And these elections, I mean, the election is going to miss, definitely. There's no doubt that Indian population is along with Prime Minister Modi. He's going to win. But what we are more interested in, what we are looking for is what next and where we are going. And I have no doubt India is going to be the global leader where it's climbing to at this point under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi along with President Trump here.
Great. I'm going to go to Vandana again. Vandana, what if BJP doesn't win? What do you think is at stake here?
BJP what is it? Doesn't win?
Yeah. That,
you're
is
getting
stake?
All negative ones.
What is at stake? What is at stake?
I think when we're talking about the federal government is going in India for the next elections, where it'll be 2019. Mm-hmm. And this results are going to be definitely impacting. But what you're asking is not coming, to be honest. We did saw how Gujarat has the impact. Gujarat brought Modi from state to federal. Central. I mean, he became a prime minister after doing so much for the state of Gujarat, and that is what the credibility has brought. And he was also there talking to his people and showing them that he's a son of the soil. Like, I still belong to you. It doesn't mean that I'm sitting in Delhi. I am yours, and I'll always stay yours. I think people of Gujarat are smart enough. We do have, I think, 55% of people of Gujarati population in U.S., and they are smart enough there, and they will do the justice to the win.
And if I can add, there are issues such as demonetization and Dalit movement and this and that and GST. But remember, the UP elections and other Bihar elections, they were all after those issues. Yeah. So he still had a landslide victory. That will repeat again.
Okay.
But Modi took the steps that he took was really, really tough, and the results are going to come out, but it takes time. But again, people in India understand that he is doing the right thing and we're moving forward, and that's what we want.
Okay, so we've had some great opinions in this panel, and I'm going to pass over the mic, and stay tuned. We'll have more people, more guests, and it's going to be a lot more opinions, a lot more discussions.
Thanks very much, Manasri. It was good to hear those voices and the opinions that you brought us from Chicago, and that is the sense of the Indian Americans there. The elections, of course, are about trends, are about what people believe, most importantly about numbers, and Karthike is very good at juggling some of those. Karthike, over to you. What do you have for us?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I'm really excited to show the breakdown of the elections on, you know, our team has built on the graphics, you know. And let us begin by looking into the key candidates and key fight, you know. That's the start of it. So when we press key candidates, we are giving you who are the main people, you know, who are the main people in Gujarat. So Shakti Singh, go ahead. He's fighting from Mandvi, Congress, close to Ahmed Patel, from the Congress party, an old guard. He's not a new guard. He's not from Rahul Gandhi's team. But yes, he's fighting. Then Jignesh Mewani, he's fighting from Wadgam. He's one of the three leaders. Hardik Patel, he's not fighting. Jignesh and Alpesh Thakur. When the agitation started after 2014, you know, they started in three particularly different communities in Gujarat for our broader viewers. The Patel community is a dominant community. Jignesh Mewani is from Scheduled Caste, which is the Harijan community. And Alpesh Thakur is a Kshatriya community, but the word Kshatriya in the context of the Gujarat is used for other backward classes, which means that they are not part of the word Kshatriya, but they are given quotas from the state. So three communities, somehow after Narendra Modi's exit, they started agitating either on the issue of quota or on the issue of violence, or in the issue of cow vigilantism, or on the issue of jobs, but for the multiple reasons, the agitation took place in Gujarat. Then Alpesh Thakur, as I mentioned,
He's fighting from Radhanpur constituency on a Congress ticket. And the whole deal is whether these three leaders have created a counter consolidation for Bharatiya Janata Party, which my colleague Arun Anand was saying, and something which we will be discussing in future. Has the three leaders created a sort of a consolidation whereby Bharatiya Janata Party is getting more and the benefits for the Congress party have been less? Though the noise and the publicity and the social media campaign has been fantastic for the Congress party. Then Nitin Bhai Patel, Mehsana BJP's senior leader, a known face, a known worker of the Bharatiya Janata Party, a seasoned organizational hand. And then Bhupendra Singh Chudasma from Dhokla. So, you know, these are the broad, I have given you names who are fighting in Gujarat. But important thing here to understand in Gujarat is, which we'll be again touching in our discussion, the fight has less to do with the state BJP leaderships and the Congress leadership in the state. It is more to do with Rahul Gandhi and the Prime Minister, or Rahul Gandhi and Amit Shah, or the various controversies from foreign affairs to Pakistan which took place. Now, we go to the key fight. You know, we'll come to the reality check a little later, but this is the key fight. So you have Indraneel Rajguru from Congress, Rajkot West, Vijay Rupani from Bharatiya Janata Party. To our viewers from abroad, Rajkot is in Saurashtra. Saurashtra is a place which is dominated by Bharatiya Janata Party, a stronghold. Even Keshubhai Kundu much damage to Narendra Modi in 2012. Now, Arjun Modwadia from Congress Party, from Porbandar. Mahatma Gandhi was born in Porbandar. It's a historic place, it's a port. Babu Bokira from Bharatiya Janata Party, but apart from the historicity of the place, which Porbandar is, Modwadia is close to the political secretary of Congress President Sonia, former Congress President Sonia Gandhi. Now the committee stand dissolved as they are. Kanti Chauhan, Congress, against Purushottam Solanki, Bharatiya Janata Party, Bhavnagar, rural area. And lastly, Dilip Gohil, Congress, Bhavnagar West, Jitu Waghani, Bharatiya Janata Party. You know, these are important state leaders. You know, we are just showing it for the benefit of our viewers. So to make them understand that there are meta-narratives when we come to, you know, talk about Himachal Pradesh elections or the Gujarat elections. But ultimately the state leaders are very, very important. And very soon, you know, we'll be telling you other issues like Gujarat and Himachal. You know, Palki, if you permit, if we have time in this segment, I can take my viewers to certain details of Himachal and Gujarat. Tell me, Palki.
We will do that in a bit. Let's get in our guests here on the panel as well. And you mentioned the two, well, we look at key candidates, but the predominant faces in this election were of Narendra Modi and Rahul Gandhi. And that's a pattern that you also see in the discourse. And I would want perhaps Daniel to weigh in on this. This is more than a state election. Doklam, Pakistan, GST, all national, perhaps even international foreign policy issues were brought up here. This is not just about Gujarat.
No, and particularly the economic policies of the central government. Like, for example, Rahul Gandhi made GST into a big, big issue, you know, because of the huge business community and small end traders that, you know, live out of Gujarat. So, you know, this is an important referendum on the policies of the government, whether they are foreign policies or domestic political as well as economic policies. And if they are unable to win this election, BJP is unable to win that election, then they are in deep trouble. That means, you know, GST has got them into trouble in a big way, because it's an election issue that was built apart from what was happening at a ground level amongst caste and other combinations.
Okay, look at the first trends. Look at those first trends. BJP 8, Congress 3. So that's a big if they don't win the election. Yes. And some others are reporting 45 to 30. 45 for the BJP, 30 for the Congress party. Out of 182 seats in Gujarat, 4 for the BJP, 3 for the Congress party of the 68 seats in Himachal Pradesh. So early trends, but...
But BJP has a lead, you know.
If
you go by the, you know, the trends which are being shown by other agencies, it's significant in numbers in terms of 19. So I'm also joined by Adil Singh from the Congress party. Sir, thank you for joining me on WION. First reaction on the early trends which are coming in.
Well, even the first round is not complete, so therefore it will be too premature to make an accurate assessment at this stage. But the fact of the matter is, coming to the campaign rhetoric, the Congress party approached the election on a positive narrative. Whether it was about job creation, whether it was about healthcare and education sector, agrarian distress, violence against the Patidars, demonetization and GST. On the contrary, the Bharatiya Janata Party...
Adil?
Yeah, can I complete?
Yes, please do.
Yeah, Palki, can I complete?
Absolutely.
Whereas the Bharatiya Janata Party had, right from the word go, had launched a very negative campaign. If you really pick up their political lexicon, it was revolving around Aurangzeb, Khilji, Pakistan, absolute non-issues which have no relevance to the people of Gujarat. For the Congress Party, this was an election about the future of 6.5 crore Gujaratis. Whereas the Bharatiya Janata Party, it was about the personal glory of one person. So that's the difference. For us, it's the issues which matter. For the Bharatiya Janata Party, issues which really matter to the people of Gujarat have been sacrificed as the altar of the personal glory of one individual. So I think that's fundamental for all of us as a country to understand. Now, coming to the second issue, there was unprecedented anger against the Bharatiya Janata Party, whether it was from the Dalits, whether it was from the Patidars, whether it was from the business community. So I think all of this is going to culminate in a very handsome victory for the Congress Party.
We'll know in a bit. Yes, Arun.
I think it's very ironical, yeah. That...
Arun, you introduce yourself. You know, Arun from our studio, Adil. You know, our guests, you know, they want to ask a couple of questions to you. Please go on, Arun.
Adil, I just want to ask, isn't it very ironical that a party which has been ruled by dynasts for the last so many decades is blaming BJP for making this election as a personal glory of a single person?
Well, I need to remind you about the number of dynasties in the Bharatiya Janata Party, whether it is Prem Kumar Dhimal, whether it is Rajnath Singh, whether it is Pankaja Munde, whether it is Vasundhara Raje Sindhya. For the Congress Party, the issues matter. If you please see the campaign material and see the issues, see our speeches. We were talking about job creation. We were talking about commercialization of healthcare and education. Did Mr. Modi talk about how electricity power generation in Gujarat has been deliberately kept close so that electricity can be purchased at exorbitant rates from a handful of companies? Did Mr. Modi apologize about the violence against the Patidars and the false sedition cases which have been slapped against hundreds of Patidar boys, or about the Una flagging? For the Congress Party, it's the issues which matter. For the BJP, it is about one individual. So, like I said earlier, that's the fundamental difference between the Congress and the BJP. This is an election about the future of Gujarat. And I think all of us here would agree to that. It is not about one individual.
I think Daniel has a question. Adil, please, Daniel, go on.
Adil.
You can be louder.
Adil, can you please tell me if the comment of Mr. Manishankar Iyer, do you see it as a watershed moment for the campaign?
Well, firstly, we've condemned that comment. We have suspended Mr. Manishankar Iyer from the party. But let me put a counter question to you, and I expect an objective response from you. What about Paresh Rawal's obnoxious tweet about the former Congress president? Did the BJP take any action against that? What about the comments of the Prime Minister making scandalous allegations against Dr. Manmohan Singh and the former Chief of Army Staff? Has the BJP apologized about that? This election is not about one comment here or there. And as far as the Congress Party is concerned, we've condemned those comments and we've taken action. Has any such action been forthcoming from the BJP? On the contrary, they defend that. Mr. Modi, the candidate, in the run-up to the 2014 elections, made derogatory comments against Dr. Manmohan Singh.
The campaign is over. I want to bring in an interesting fact here.
We've suspended him from the party.
Sure. Great. Two wrongs don't make a right, and that's all I'm going to say to that. But I've got some interesting data here, and Jasper, you may want to look at this. If wealth creation from equity markets is taken as an indicator of voter sentiment, the people of Gujarat should be happy, because they have benefited significantly from the 70% rise in the Sensex and Nifty over the last 4 years. 54.4 lakh voters, 4 lakh people, that is the country's second largest population of registered investors after Maharashtra in terms of investments in mutual funds. I'm just giving one indicator when we talk about the Gujarat model, and then we look at the trading of charges and the mudslinging during the campaign trail. Do you think that the voter discounts that this is going to happen? They are going to go at each other. But I have to look at what this leader or that leader has done for me and I have to vote. How much of this negative discourse plays on the mind of the voter during the campaign, you think?
Well, I think it's a very interesting question. There's no... I mean, listen, even after campaigning today, we're seeing an awful lot of kind of low-level tactical mudslinging, right? And I think, you know, that's on top of social media chit-chat, on top of mass media coverage. So, I mean, we were talking about this before. There is an innate need for the voter to cut through this noise, right? And whether it's the equity markets going on a bull run, which benefits Gujarat, I have to say it doesn't benefit everyone in Gujarat, it benefits the top end of society, or whether it's brand Modi, I can't help but think that you know, people need a shorthand here, right? They need a shorthand to cut through all of this stuff. And you know, if that's the markets and you're feeling good, you'll vote for that. If you like the look of Modi and you're familiar with him, you'll vote for that. I don't think you'll vote for a bunch of chit-chat.
Right, and I can tell our viewers that there's a lot of numbers doing the rounds here. Many are saying that the first trends are coming on as many as 115 seats in Gujarat, but we're going slow because we're looking at the leads as they come in, and we will put out those numbers only when we're sure that the BJP or the Congress party, as the case might be, is leading on one seat. So at the moment, 8 for the BJP, 3 for the Congress, and these are just leads. These are not final results. Harish Khurana is still with us, Karthikeyan.
Mr. Khurana, if you go by the leads, there is one very important development which is taking place. I want your response. Both Alpesh Thakur and Jignesh, they're trailing. BJP candidates are far ahead.
Sorry, I'm not getting you.
Alpesh Thakur.
Sorry? Can you repeat again, please?
Alpesh Thakur, Mr. Khurana, and Jignesh,
yeah?
Both are trailing.
Yeah.
BJP candidates are ahead. Your comment, sir.
That's what I'm saying. People of Gujarat has voted for development, not for casteism. We should understand that. And I was listening to the Congress panelist, supporter of Congress panelist. He was saying, they were talking about development. Who started the Vikas Pagal Ho Gaya? Who started Gabbar Singh tax? These kind of mockery of these things, who started that? So my question is, this was the election clearly between the 22 years of development done by BJP government, first led by Narendra Modi and then by Vijay Bhai. And now you're talking about versus casteism. Casteism led by Rahul Gandhi with the three boys, Alpesh, Jignesh and Hardik.
You know,
Gujarat people has rejected that.
Mr. Khurana, I would like Adil to react. Adil, please react to what Mr. Khurana has said, saying that the caste arithmetic was particularly a brainchild of the Congress party deployed by them. Tell me, the whole argument which
and
was there.
And a supplement question, if the Congress loses, which it well might, who is going to take the responsibility, Adil?
Karthike, the fact of the matter is, if the people were so happy and the BJP was so confident about their so-called Gujarat model, why didn't we not hear the Prime Minister speak about it more often? Why was the Prime Minister's entire campaign rhetoric centered around the Congress party and the Congress president? If they're so confident, they should have showcased their model. But their model is Gujarat is 18th on the literacy index and 21st on the malnutrition index. Now, responding to Mr. Khurana's question, there was unprecedented anger. Lakhs and lakhs of people were out in the streets, whether it was Surat, whether it was Baroda, Ahmedabad, Gandhinagar. That was the anger against the BJP and their ill-advised economic policies. And now, if individuals from several communities join the Congress party, we're a political party. We welcome support at the time of elections and even otherwise. It is a manifestation of the anger against the Bharatiya Janata Party. And I'll tell you, an objective parameter to really gauge this is, please analyze the Prime Minister's speeches and please analyze Mr. Rahul Gandhi's speeches. We were centered around issues. For us, job creation matters. Boosting employment matters. Justice for all matters.
I'll give you ample time.
Whereas for the BJP,
just bear with me for
it
a
was
second.
Centered around the Congress party.
Adil, just bear with me for a second. Yes, Khurana, Mr. Khurana, go on. Yes.
I think Adil is a good orienter and a good speaker, but right now, the question is, who will take the responsibility of this defeat? will Rahul Gandhi will owe this? Because the reason is, in this whole election, Rahul Gandhi was the only face of Congress in Gujarat. He was talking about only and only about Gabbar tax. He was talking about Vikas Pagal ho gaya. Now, the question is, what I am asking the same question. It was an election between development and the casteism. Will Rahul Gandhi will accept their fault, what he has done?
Can I respond to this,
yes,
Karthik?
Please go ahead.
Well, firstly, Mr. Khurana is proceeding on a wrong assumption. The BJP is not winning this election. The Congress Party will win this election. And I say that confidently after analyzing and sensing the mood of the people of Gujarat. That's point number one. Point number two, the Congress president has never shirked away for responsibility. For us, it's the future of this country matters. Did Mr. Amit Shah take responsibility after Punjab? Did Mr. Amit Shah take responsibility after Goa? Did Mr. Amit Shah take responsibility after Bihar? Did Mr. Amit Shah take responsibility after Delhi? Did Mr. Amit Shah take responsibility after Manipur? So let's not get down to that. The fact of the matter is the BJP had launched a negative campaign, whereas the Congress party's campaign was centered about the real issues. Till now, we haven't heard a forthcoming response from the BJP on the Rafael scam. It still baffles the country. Why was HAL removed from an offset contract? And why was a 21,000 crore rupee offset contract given to a defaulter? I think these are issues which perhaps Mr. Khurana can now respond. Because Mr. Modi hasn't responded to all this. But in
the
sense of the people of Gujarat, Khurana Sahab, it is the sense of the people. There were lakhs and lakhs of people out in the streets. That's the general sentiment.
Right. Let's give it a break. Let's look at pictures from Chicago and the people there are also looking at election results. The first trends are clearly showing that the BJP is leading in 80 seats against the Congress's 51, Karthike, and that sets the mood, really. And these are pictures, live pictures, from the Ronald Reagan Center in Chicago, where Indian Americans have gathered to join in on this election celebration.
If we go by the trends which are coming in, the difference is substantial. Both in Himachal Pradesh, it's double, and again, it's very, very substantial when it comes to Gujarat.
Okay, too bad for the BJP; they've not voted. But that's the sentiment outside India, and that might well be the case in Gujarat, certainly the case in Himachal Pradesh. It looks like a foregone conclusion. Sharad Gupta has been sitting very patiently with us. Good morning. What do you make of the way things are going?
Very initial trends, both in Himachal and Gujarat. So mostly, only the postal ballots are coming. And let's wait for another half an hour at least for the trends to crystallize. And the leads to basically consolidate. So then only we'll be able to predict which way the wind is blowing. But right now it seems that Congress is headed for a rout and BJP going for a landslide win. But as I said, let's wait for some more time.
But it depends. You know, I think you have a point, because if you look at those fluctuations, let me just inform our panel and the viewers. It's not as if the fluctuation is wild. It's like, if you look at the...
82-54.
Yeah, it's somewhere it's 72-52, you know. So it's like that, you know. We are showing you what the Election Commission data is giving us.
That's essentially postal ballots.
Yes, that's essentially the postal ballots. But there are other private agencies, you know, which directly relay information from the counting centers. So some say it's 72 BJP, 53 Congress. So it will all depend. Urban and rural counting centers behave differently. Right. It also depends on when your voters have come out to vote. So I think we'll have to give it another 1.5 hours to get a clear trend, at least an hour, to have a clear trend when it comes to Gujarat.
You're saying Congress don't lose heart.
It's not about Congress losing heart, because I have seen Delhi, I have seen Bihar, where BJP in initial trend did extremely well, and suddenly... that happened in Bihar, and suddenly the Aam Aadmi Party did extremely well. And I remember in 2012, you'll be very surprised, Palki, when the ballot boxes opened, the party with the largest number in 2012 UP Assembly election was Bharatiya Janata Party, but eventually SP won.
Okay, so We'll wait for an hour. We're not calling the election anyway. We have Andrew K.P. Long standing by and Glenn Carl, American writer with us from Boston in the U.S. Good morning, Glenn. And Andrew, I'm told you have to leave, so let me put this question to you. What would a win mean for the Prime Minister of India here in Gujarat especially?
I think that this is a contest between a national agenda, India as a country, local agenda, characterized by economic. That's one side. Now, the other side of it, the international geopolitics with the investment in White House and also, I think,
I'm afraid your audio isn't clear. Good morning, Glenn. It's election day. It's counting day here in India. From the looks of it, the BJP might win both the states, the Prime Minister's home state of Gujarat and Himachal Pradesh, which has been seeing anti-incumbency. How do you see this election result? Is it just about two states in India, or is there a bigger message?
I don't think there will be a message unless and that would send a change. Otherwise, from the one is in the Trump or party in business, what counts really is how significant economic is and how small economic is. Then there's the seeing strategic affinity between India and the United States and China. And the only thing that would change that would be where the BJP should come. Now, that's not an endorsement of BJP. I don't think anyone really cares which party is in power. A lot of comment about how Modi is saying the right things. I think that really doesn't count at all as of American officials, businessmen. What counts is the growth rate, stability, and the increasing openness of the.
I think the voice was not audible. But my question is, if you look at the data, Palki, which is very widely fluctuating, it tells us one thing, that despite a very powerful campaign and also Congress giving a good fight, because more than 30 MLAs who belong to the Shankar Singh Wagela camp were denied the tickets. Despite that, the leads which are coming in from others is like 80-55. It also goes on to show that the difference is 25. And when the rural ballot boxes open, because generally if you look at urban and in rural areas, you're in morning, you have bigger lines. In urban areas, the line can improve after 2 p.m. and 3 p.m. Yes, you wanted to make a point?
Last time, the difference was almost from 66.
Mm-hmm.
If the trends are to be believed, the difference has reduced to 30 seats. So Congress has actually gained.
But I don't know how much.
Kushan doesn't agree.
It's your first round. It's
round. We have to wait for at least 10 rounds for us to arrive.
Wait a while. Yeah. Let's not jump the mark, as Karthike rightly said. You know, what can happen is by round 5 or 6, it could start, you know, when they go to strong areas where the EVMs are coming from. We don't know that as yet. So let's not go with postal ballot trends and let's not jump ahead of the mark.
But what I'm really surprised about is the state which we have not discussed.
That's Himachal
Pradesh. Himachal Pradesh, the old man, Veerbhadra Singh, is giving a good fight. The state which was supposed to be gone and completely swept away. You know, if you look at the data, he is giving a good, though BJP is leading, but he is still giving a good fight. Rahul Gandhi did only one rally in Himachal Pradesh, maybe two rallies. The whole focus was in
That's
Gujarat.
That's a bit of a trend, isn't it? He didn't go to Punjab and Amrinder Singh won, so maybe the problem is with Rahul Gandhi.
You know, he did one rally in Manipur. Abhi Singh still, despite losing the election, Congress was the single largest party. And the rebels of the Congress, the Hemant Biswa Sarma, ultimately had to cobble a coalition under their chief minister.
Adil, do you know where the problem lies now?
That is what I'm saying. Palki ji, let me correct you factually. Rahul Gandhi ji had 6 rallies in Gujarat. Not 2 rallies, but 6 rallies. And he was regularly in touch with the state leaders.
We're talking
That's just
about
a factual inaccuracy.
Himachal Pradesh, not Gujarat.
No, I'm talking about Himachal as well. Rahul Gandhi ji had 6 rallies in Gujarat. and he was regularly in touch. Not two rallies.
But Adil, it pales in comparison to what he did in Gujarat. My point was the sort of focus which existed for Gujarat when it came to AICC, and the sort of campaigning which took place in Himachal. The point is, Veerbhadra Singh is still giving a good fight. He's the grand old man of the Congress Party. If you look at it, he entered politics in 1952.
Kartike, Mr. Veerbhadra Singh is a five-time former chief minister and the incumbent chief minister, and hopefully the next chief minister as well. Therefore, we had a sitting chief minister. Therefore, he was given more weightage and he was more active in the state. But Rahul Gandhiji had six rallies. He was regularly in touch with the leaders. So therefore, I think that's an unfair comment to make that Rahul Gandhiji did not spend adequate time in Himachal. Whereas in Gujarat, we were out of power for 22 years. So therefore, there was more emphasis on Gujarat. So I think that's the nuanced differentiation which is important to make here.
But coming back to Gujarat, you know, if you look at the data which our sister concern ZTV is flashing, it has gone to 87.65. So the fluctuation is vile. Yes, Daniel.
Tweet made by BJP Ahmedabad.
Mm-hmm.
It says trends on 160 seats, BJP leading in on 93, Congress on 63.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and others on 4. Now this is the BJP.
Which means that the space for others have shrunk.
Mm. Yeah.
It basically is boiling down to the fact that this space for others is shrinking. Unlike the last time, there is no big other.
But last time the others were what? Six?
Last time, if I'm not wrong, the others went to...
Six.
See, others went to even 12% in terms of the percentage. Others in terms of voting percentage got more than 10. Yes, you wanted to say something, Arun.
No, I just want to say, more than BJP, this election is crucial for Congress. Because if BJP loses Gujarat, okay, that's fine. Mm. It's a home state of the Prime Minister, but BJP is still ruling in a large number of states. But the way Rahul Gandhi has campaigned in Gujarat, and the way Congress has really fought this election tooth and nail. So even if now, if they lose Gujarat, and if they lose Gujarat with a decent margin, I think it will be very, very difficult for Congress to resurrect itself before 2019.
Yes, and we saw a map of India, which was largely saffron, barring a few odd states. And there are also some images, some pictures, live pictures coming in of BJP workers celebrating and sharing sweets already. So, well, the numbers may not say it, but perhaps they're sure. They did that? They haven't learned then.
But I think Palki, the moot question is, before we call off the results and that's the havan which is being done.
Huh?
But those are prayers in process, you know, for the final result. But is it, my question to the whole panel is Gujarat election or should Gujarat election be treated as a referendum to Narendra Modi's politics? Should it be? Starting from you, Kushan.
I mean, at the end of the day, one reason I think the BJP will hold Gujarat despite what the Congress says is because there must be a level of Gujarati pride at having a prime minister, right? I mean... How can you not vote for the Prime Minister from your own state? You should vote for him. They might want to punish the BJP for being inefficient ever since Mr. Modi left Gujarat. But I still think they'll vote for him. I don't think Gujarat or Himachal Pradesh is going to be a referendum on the Prime Minister because you know how varied India is. Just like Uttar Pradesh was not a referendum on Narendra Modi. I mean, not a ringing endorsement of his policies.
Is it just about pride? Is there an element of pragmatism as well? The Gujarati is essentially a businessman who knows that the Prime Minister at the center is going to decide the policy for the foreseeable future, and so you do not want to upset him.
Yeah, there's a level of pragmatism, but yeah.
Well, I totally agree. This is the home game of home games, right? He should win it, right? And whether it's pragmatism. Mm. Or pride, voting for your guy is kind of what this probably boils down to. So I agree. I don't think it's a referendum on Modi. Turning it back to the Congress, I equally slightly disagree that it's a catastrophe if Congress come out of this with anything other than the terrible showing. It's a long game here, right? We made the point here that it's a five-test series, right? This is only one test match, and it's a home ground test match. We should play a longer game.
Yeah, we should play much longer game. See, I just want to make a point. No, what Kushan was saying, I agree with him. I also want to add to this that, you know, this election, while the national press reported, I have made this point earlier also, while the national press has reported hugely on the national issues, but this election was not fought on the GST or on I'm saying that it did play a slight this thing, but largely in assembly elections, the local...
I think that's debatable, but it's time for a short break. And ahead of the results, the Chief Election Commission, E.R. Achal Kumar Jyoti, denied claims of EVM hacking by the opposition. Listen in.
EVM के बारे में जो प्रश्न कुछ लोगों ने उठाए हैं उसका उत्तर हमने मीडिया में भी दिया है और मैं आपको कहना चाहूंगा कि EVM जिनके द्वारा वोटिंग होता है EVM और VVPAT उसके अंदर VVPAT की व्यवस्था सभी 50,250 पोलिंग स्टेशन में करी गई थी जिसमें गुजरात के दरेक वोटर ने जिसको वोट दिया था उसको वो अपनी आंखों से देख सकता था ऐसी व्यवस्था VVPAT में है इसलिए EVM के द्वारा जो वोटिंग के बारे में जो मुद्दे उठाए जा रहे हैं वो ठीक नहीं है और आई कैन अश्योर यू और मैं आपको विश्वास दिलाता हूं कि EVM को टेम्परिंग नहीं हो सकता है ये हमने पूरे विश्वास के साथ मैं आपको यकीन दिलाना चाहता हूं